In 1948, after the fall of Germany in World War II, the Soviet Union blocked off all trade routes and entrances to West Berlin, trapping the Berliners inside with limited food and other life necessities. In response, Britain and the US launched an airlift that supplied thousands of tons of food for the people of West Berlin. This airlift not only succeeded in ending the Berlin blockade in 1949, but also gave the Allies a propaganda victory and created an understanding between America and Germany. However, it also led to the creation of the Berlin Wall and intensified the conflict between capitalist and communist countries. The communication necessary for the Berlin airlift greatly influenced relations between the Eastern and Western world. After the end of World War I, the Treaty of Versailles imposed stringent restrictions on Germany, leaving their national economy in disarray. So, when the Great Depression struck, Adolf Hitler manipulated German citizens to rally behind him by voicing his desires to end poverty, starvation, and the threat of communism. Once in power, he went to war with Europe, starting World War II on September 1, 1939. When Germany surrendered in May of 1945, a prime opportunity arose for the Allies to impose their will on the country. The Soviet Union and the Western Allies, France, Britain, and the US, had fought together in World War II to defeat a common enemy. However, the Soviets and the Western Allies disagreed greatly about the best economic system. In the Western Allies' capitalism, people decide at what price they are willing to buy and sell goods. However, in the Soviets' communism, the government controls all creation and distribution of goods. The Western Allies despise the inefficiency and control that came with the Soviets' economic system. Despite this disagreement, the Allies were able to communicate with each other at the peace conferences in Yalta and Potsdam to determine the fate of post-war Germany. They decided that each ally was to be given a section of the country, as well as a section of the capital, Berlin, despite it being geographically deep within the Soviet-controlled section of Germany. In 1948, diplomatic ties between the Western Allies and the Soviet Union started to deteriorate with the disbandment of the makeshift German government, called the Allied Control Council. Tensions worsened when the Western Allies released the Deutschmark, a new currency that sought to economically rehabilitate Germany. This angered the Soviet Union, as it ran contrary to a previous agreement that the United States and Britain had just grossly violated. Coupled with the previous announcements of the Truman Doctrine, an aggressive plan to stop the spread of communism, published on March 12, 1947, and the Marshall Plan, a capitalist program to economically rehabilitate Europe, published on April 3, 1948, the Soviets feared they were losing their grasp on Germany. This fear led the Soviets to seize control over Berlin by blockading all land and sea routes to it. This ensured that no citizen could leave or enter, and that no resources could be delivered by the Western Allies by conventional means. The Soviets then offered to feed the people of Berlin themselves, to ensure victory in the public's eyes, and to gain the upper hand in negotiations surrounding Berlin's future. The Allies knew accepting the Soviets' offer to feed the people would result in a loss of prestige and a significant failure in the fight against communism. For the same reasons, leaving Berlin was not an option. And as noted by Vyacheslav Molotov, the Soviet foreign minister, what happens to Berlin happens to Germany. What happens to Germany happens to Europe. However, letting the 2 million Berliners starve was not an option. Further complications arose from the threat of a Third World War, which the Soviets claimed that the United States and Britain were participating in a policy of. Despite all these factors, a decision had to be made. The Allies would remain in Berlin and supply the city by air. As President Harry Truman famously said, "We shall stay." Period.
On June 26, 1948, the United States launched Operation Vittles to supply the trapped people of West Berlin by air. They planned to travel through three pre-established airways over Germany that remained unguarded by the Soviets. That day, hundreds of American and British planes took to the sky. Landing West Berlin, they harbored tons of food, coal, and medicine. Generals Curtis LeMay, Lucius Clay, and William Tunner were largely responsible for the logistics of the operation. In their elaborate plan, C-47 planes would fly from West Germany into the Tempelhof and Gatow airports in Berlin, taking the northernmost and southernmost air corridors to get there. After the planes were unloaded, they would fly back through the central air corridor to restock and start the process over again. The people of Berlin needed coal for heating and industry, as well as food, which was grown in America and transported across the Atlantic to West Germany. These resources and necessities were delivered around the clock to the people of Berlin. An Air Force pilot once said, "We had no guns, only flour." Although the people of West Berlin lived in extreme poverty, The resources the airlift supplied allowed the people to eat, stay warm, and work while fending off communists.
Flights were going day and night. I mean, they weren't just at a certain time. And so it took a while to get comfortable again.
To supply the right amount of resources and avoid redundancy, the British and Americans had to communicate with each other about their supplies, their planes, and their plans. There was also extensive communication between the different parts of the U.S. and British military. A perfectly efficient supply chain had to be set up, which involved the communication of dozens of farms and thousands of officials. Finally, pilots and air control had to communicate in order to deliver an implausible amount of goods at a steady rate. Despite the blockade lasting for 11 months, the Allies were able to sustain Operation Vittles. In fact, the total amount of goods delivered to the people increased, partly due to the planes left over from World War II being brought in. However, the main reasons the airlift succeeded was the intensive communication and the tireless work of the pilots themselves. Thousands of military personnel worked upwards of 18 hours a day. As one pilot put it, all we did was eat, sleep, and fly. Every hour, the pilots would load tons of supplies and resources onto their planes. When flying, there were sometimes only 90 seconds between departures. Sadly, the airlift also took a great toll, killing 83 people in plane crashes, 13 of which were German civilians. But, in the end, the continued dangerous work of the pilots paid off. By the end of the blockade, the Allies were supplying 6,000 tons of food a day, making a grand total of 2.3 million tons of food and coal. The continued success of the Allies led the Soviets to understand that their hopes of forcing the Allied powers out of Germany were in vain. And so, on May 12, 1949, the Soviet Union lifted their blockade around Berlin, freeing the citizens of the capital and granting the United States a major public victory against communism.
The most immediate effect of the airlift was a new view of world politics. The Allies were seen as ingenuitive, invincible, and able to save an entire city without firing a shot. The Soviets, on the other hand, were seen as bullies, willing to starve millions just to fend back capitalism. The United States made the most out of this opportunity, creating widespread anti-communist propaganda. The Soviets also spread propaganda, emphasizing to their citizens how they had offered to supply food to West Berlin and thus prevented added hardships of the population. These acts of government-citizen communication widened the gap between the two countries. Before the blockade, the major superpowers of the world were working together to make sense of a post-World War II Earth. But the cruelty of the blockade communicated to everyone the Soviets' willingness to gain power by force. This aggression did not sit well with the capitalist allies. The world had entered the Cold War, a dark period in history where the capitalist and communist nations stockpiled thousands of nuclear weapons capable of mass destruction. Although the blockade widened the gap between the US and the USSR, it brought the former enemies, the US and Western Germany, together. As historian Armin Gribicher noted, quote, "The Americans were now seen as protectors rather than occupiers," unquote. When the West German state was created in 1949, it became a capitalist barrier against communism. On August 13, 1961, another major Cold War conflict would start in Berlin. In the wake of the failure of the Berlin blockade, the Soviets tried to assert their power over Berlin a second time. In the middle of the night, the Soviet Union built a 27-mile-long wall to stop the migration of East Berliners into the capitalist world. The success of the Berlin airlift led the Soviets to this desperate power grab. In the end, this wall separated countless families, communicated the Soviets' priority of government strength, and increased the Western hatred for the USSR. The Cold War would continue, as more and more weapons were created just to prove that one side was stronger. The US and the USSR aimed these weapons at one another, and along with China, fought proxy wars in Korea in 1950 through 1953, and Vietnam from 1955 to 1973. The Cold War would remain until the Berlin Wall fell, reuniting Berlin and marking the beginning of the dissolution of the Soviet Union. Now, United Germany and the US continue to help each other out economically and politically. The Berlin airlift is annually commemorated in a once-starved city of Berlin. Thanks are given to the pilots who risked their lives and the loading crews who spent hours a day doing intense physical labor, and the countries willing to feed an entire city. To this day, the Berlin airlift is the largest air support mission in history, and it was only possible through communication between the many pilots, government allies, and loading crews. The airlift shifted politics from a place of union to a deep conflict between economic systems, leading to the Cold War. This brought with it propaganda, fear of nuclear war, and a 27-mile-long wall. Finally, Western Germany became a bulwark against communism and one of the United States' closest allies. The communication that enabled the Berlin airlift changed world politics forever.